Great to have you all here this evening. We're delighted to welcome Frank Field. Frank is the Labour MP for Birkenhead. He was first elected to the House of Commons in 1979. A lifelong campaigner for social justice, Frank is currently the co-chair of the all-party parliamentary group on hunger and food poverty. Not necessarily one to toe the party line, however, Frank has often been a vocal critic of Labour Party leaders, including former Prime Ministers Tony Blair and Gordon Brown. As for the event this evening, we'll start with a short 30 to 40 minute interview with Frank. We'll then open the floor to questions from you guys, and then following the event there'll be a short wine reception where you'll be able to pick Frank's brains about all things general election 2015, so I hope you'll be able to join us for that. So without further ado.
So this year, Frank has been an MP for 35 years. During the 35 years, Frank, is there any defining moment that sticks out for you? Is there any time at all where you felt you'd become disheartened with politics?
I'm ambivalent about that. If you look at 35 years and say, what have I achieved? I don't think I've achieved very much. But then why should any one person achieve very much? I mean, it's a huge country, over 60 million people. It'd be totally wrong to think you could. And yet, my father did a factory job and hated getting up every day to go to work, though he did go to work, even when he was not well. And I'd never had that experience. I mean, every day I longed for the day to start and to get on with it. And that's an incredible privilege, and to get paid for it. As well, and paid not badly. So it's been a fantastic life. I remember going up to George and Kath, who George is the chairman of Birkenhead Labour Party, and I'm not giving any secrets, though I didn't tell anyone for 10 years in Birkenhead because I thought it was so damaging to me. I was working a Saturday afternoon in an organisation that I worked for, Child Poverty Action Group, and I heard a news flash that Ed Mundell, the trade secretary, wasn't standing again, his Birkenhead seat, and I thought, God, this is going to be the last seat vacant before the election. I'm going to be serious about trying to get it. But what I knew about Birkenhead then, it was a shipbuilding town, and I thought shipbuilding towns had to be in the northeast. So I got this mega ultrasound looking for Birkenhead. Like, where is it? It's a proper place. I mean, it must be here. And then my eye fell on the other side of the country. I thought, so I get the train from Euston, not King's Cross. But I was up for two seats, Dudley West, where I got practically all the nominations. And Birkenhead, I got a fringe nomination for. And I went to spend a day by myself in each seat. And I left Dudley West, it gave me the creeps. I couldn't bear it, the people were so unfriendly. And I was so unnerved by that, I got some canvas cards so I could pretend I was doing something useful in Birkenhead. And I got out in Hamilton Square Station and got to the bus stop, thinking where I was going to go to do my canvas. And people started talking to me and I thought, this is the one I'm going to try for. Dudley West, they shortlisted on the same day, were selecting on the same day, and I told them that if I was shortlisted at Birkenhead, I was going to Birkenhead. And the secretary phoned me up and said, What are they offering you? And I said, I've got this fringe nomination. She said, but it's sewn up for you here. And I didn't have the courage to say, well, I didn't want to go to Dudley. And then after the election, we both went in with 10,000 majorities, both seats. We got a majority in Birkenhead, and the Dudley seat was lost. And she phoned me up and said, what did you know that we didn't know? Anyway, some 35 years of great, great happiness for me.
So we know that Tony Blair asked you to think of the unthinkable and welfare. Are Ian Duncan Smith's reforms all too different from your own vision? And do you think a future Labour government would be more receptive to these proposals?
Although Tony Blair, who was pretty relax with the use of language. Used to say that I was given the task of thinking the unthinkable. I've never thought the unthinkable. The whole of my life's been about what's workable. If we were in government, what can we do next? And what will be the consequences of that? And how do we genuinely actually counter those unforeseen consequences if they're bad? So I was never given that task. Now, my view from with Ian Duncan Smith is totally different. I mean, Ian Duncan Smith is a good person fallen amongst a daft idea. And the idea is this universal credit. And what we need here is to actually get wages higher so that taxpayers aren't subsidising employers who thrive with low wages. Now, is York actually... Does everybody who's contracted at York, do they all get a living wage? Are you a living wage employer here? Anyway, so there's a campaign to be done, isn't there, after your exams. Citizens. I mean, it's outrageous that when you look at the Football League and the transfer fees are up, or the television rights, and Andrew, who works with me, he's the brains really behind the whole show, is a great football fanatic, and we wrote to all the Premier clubs to say, you know, this is your second big dump of money you're spending. How many of you pay a living wage to all your staff, whether they're on the books or contracted out? A lot of them couldn't be bothered to reply. And as you know, only Chelsea and Everton, I won't stress the colours, have actually committed themselves. And it shows if one can, or two can, the others can. So, but Ian Duncan Smith's his scheme about signing everybody onto a universal credit is going to institutionalise, yet again, low wages. Because although he thinks somehow people can get out of bed, who don't want to get out of bed, will do so because they're going to be marginally better off, are just mistakes why some people don't work, and mistakes why other people are desperate to get jobs. And the vision I had, which I thought, I mean, Gordon Brown was the senior person, so I thought, well, his ideas aren't workable. But that would be seen. And therefore, you know, the insurance proposal that I had, you know, that people are only in the long run going to support welfare if they think it's fair. They won't if they think it's unfair. That's why the Tories are ahead of us on welfare. They don't think our proposals were actually fair. It's got to be that you pay in before you go out. And if you do that, you've got no problem with people coming from abroad because they haven't paid in, so they can't draw out. End of discussion. And they only draw out when they've paid in enough like everybody else. So it's a totally different vision. And if you look at Labour's big schemes about e-borders, about linking our hospital, our doctors' records to hospitals, there has not been a big IT scheme that any government has been successful with. So why do we think Ian Duncan Smith is going to be the exception to the rule? And I thought it was gentle of us to say, that, you know, we would volunteer a committee in which we'd help the Tories salvage universal credit. I mean, what would we bring to the table? We couldn't run our own IT schemes, big ones, big reforms. And I do think it's a general point about reform that if you're serious about IT reforms, you ought to start in local offices and get the cleverest people in those offices to start working at how they would design a system which would link with other offices and so on. So the short answer, you see, one of my problems is I can't stop talking, so I've got the time. I've got lots of questions. Ian Duncan Smith wants a mega, 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 he wants us all on means tests. And while he may not know where it's going to go, if it ever worked, the idea will to be abolished the rest of the welfare state. You will only get support if, in fact, you're below a certain level of income. And that will apply to pensioners and all the rest of it. That's the direction. This policy and the opportunities, if you can call them that, it gives foolish politicians. The alternative is a much more mundane one, and that is that you know, we've got to build up responsibility. You build up responsibility by people making contributions and giving them some sense that they can actually own it as well. It's not just paying in and sometimes drawing out. So this is what I thought Blair had told me he'd signed up to, and I thought that when it was clear that Gordon's proposals were not going to work, that we would then adopt. And of course, all we did was try and fix the figures to show it was working, but it clearly wasn't working. And we had a system which broke up full-time jobs because you got, you know, you could get employer benefits if you got part-time jobs and all the rest of it. It's a nightmare, and with huge millions of poorly paid workers are still trapped in this scheme.
Just moving on from that, it's very interesting. It's known you had a very close relationship with late Lady Margaret Thatcher. Obviously, she was a giant in British politics. She was a very divisive figure as well. But not many people in the audience may know who the real Maggie was. So I wonder if you had any tales to tell about yourself and Margaret.
One which I think is relevant to today, because we actually do have to pick up this whole business about the grotesqueness of the inequalities in our society. After she had been thrown out by the Tories, who just barred me, aren't they? I mean, they'd have won the election with her, and the idea that he wasn't going to win another election. And I said to her, "What's your greatest disappointment, Mrs. T, as Prime Minister?" And without any hesitation, she said, "I cut taxes because I thought we'd get a giving society, and we haven't." And this whole business now of how do we tame this new wealth? I wrote a paper that... I'm all in favour of people behaving themselves, so in theory I'm in favour of antisocial behaviour orders, but I think we should have ones for the rich. And that, in fact, that we would expect them to give so much of their wealth away, and not through their own foundations, through charities, that if they didn't, we would actually take it in taxation. But not to spend as taxes, but then to put it out in the community into schemes where other people can make decisions rather than us politicians. And I think on that, it's just one thing. But I thought I might get a question on Mrs. T, so I've got something out of paper today, where it again says in her book, The Path to Power, she says, it is far from clear that a capitalist economy can continue to function if substantial minorities flout the moral rules and conventions under which everybody else is expected to operate. And I think that's a huge warning to the system we have now. We don't have an alternative to it, but it's clearly unacceptable that we've got people who are hungry and we've got people who pay £50,000 for handbag.
So do you think if Thatcher was still on today, she, you know, what kind of message do you think she would take to kind of address that?
I'd like to think, who knows, I'd like to think she would be rigorously imposing antisocial behaviour orders on the rich. Teach them how to do their duty.
Exactly.
And the duty of great wealth is to spread it and not to hoard it.
Do you think that's something Labour failed to do when they were in power?
I think one of our real weaknesses is that people don't think we are prepared to take on the powerful. And I think we should be, I mean, this election it won't be, it's the election after this that the Greens will worry lots of us in what used to be safe seats. But, I mean, they've dropped all their greenery stuff, but they do come over as we're standing up against the bullies. And I think it's immensely important to have a major political party, which is the Labour Party, which takes the sword to these bullies. And even if you lose, the electorate give you credit for trying. They're fed up with you not trying.
So you recently criticised Gordon Brown's leadership, most notably leading a backbench revolt in 2007 to sabotage his planned abolition of the 10p tax rate, which was set to hurt hundreds of thousands of the poorest in Britain. What was your relationship like with Brown, and do you think Miliband would do a better job as Prime Minister?
Cameras are on.
We'll edit it.
When Gordon first came into the House, I thought this is our promised leader. And we then had a session when someone's not going to come and hit me. We had a session before the 1997 election, and I thought it was a genuine discussion. and I disagreed with him, and I walked out the Shell Cabinet room. I heard this noise behind me, and I was thrown around, and I was shaken like a rag doll, saying, "You disagreed with this, you disagreed with my friend!" And I thought, "You are mad." My job is to prevent you being Prime Minister, and I failed in that. But I was one of the five that voted against him in the parliamentary party. And I thought Blair would have been braver in standing up to this nonsense. And it was a real nastiness entered British politics with that. And we're still not rid of it. And the idea that your colleagues can disagree with you and the electorate aren't bright enough to actually welcome disagreements conducted in a civilised way, I think belittles the electorate and also makes the process of government harder. So I had my differences with Gordon. Unfortunately, I didn't. I do remember that the last time I saw Blair as Prime Minister, and I said to Blair, I said, "Tony, we haven't got a candidate. You cannot let Mrs. Rochester out. You hear her every night, clawing at the walls, trying to get out." I said, "We cannot let her out till we've got a candidate." And he laughed. The first time ever he showed any, he was so good, you could never tell when you were talking to him what he thought of colleagues or anything or ideas. he laughed at this, and then he let him out. And we all know the story that resulted. So, yeah, it was not our finest hour, was it?
And your opinions on Ed Miliband?
I think, Ed, we've got, 80-odd days? I think he should get out of these people advising what to say and all the rest of it, and just get do a major, really, and get on a box and start shouting the things he really believes.
Fantastic. Moving on from that. In December 2014, you released Feeding Britain, your report with your cross-parliamentary group, Fascinating Read. I just wondered if you thought austerity was one of the key reasons behind the rise in food bank usage and which measures should be taken to address that.
It clearly can't help, can it, the austerity measures. I thought our theme for this Parliament should be, first of all, hold our hands up about the debt. And not the public debt, is that by far and away the most damaging? The most damaging was that we allowed, because of a relaxed regulation, private debt to increase. And then when the slump hit us, people were naturally scared and tried to run down as they could their private debt. And that was the real effect on consumption and employment at that period of time. And I also thought, as well as doing that with our hands, we should say they won't cut fairly and they won't distribute fairly. And we spent quite a lot of the Parliament denying the business about the debt, and never getting over the key thing, they won't cut fairly. And then you've got a theme for the electorate, the whole Parliament, and they won't distribute fairly, nor will they. But it's quite late to try and get that message over. But if you look at food banks, they're not just in this country, and they haven't just happened with the election of a Tory government. They're much more pronounced in Canada, the United States, Germany, France, but growing here. And for me, the importance of that is something terrible is happening to how so-called advanced Western economies operate. The bottom's falling out for the poor. And that does need us to rethink the sort of politics and therefore the policies and therefore the sort of economy that we actually want. And of course it's great that we have sticking plasters, because if you're hungry, you can't wait for politicians to get around about how you solve Western capitalism. But we need to take the debate on from food banks, and we also need seriously think about, and it comes back to standing up for people who are the oppressed. If the European Union could actually focus on some real issues instead of trying to bully us all the time, it could be popular. And one is that we are all in the same boat. There are things happening in the world economy which are disadvantaging, not the rich, the European Union, but the poor. And we ought to try and have strategies to counter that. but we don't. But it comes back to your earlier point about the 10p tax rate. How do we change fiscally, monetarily, and what sort of public services should we have which try to underpin and undergirth the very poorest in our society so they still feel members one with another, with the rest of us? And I couldn't believe Gordon had, just a wrong foot Cameron had, decided to abolish the 10p when he'd actually introduced it. Just one comment about that. He got away with it the first year, but the budget changes came in the second year, so I was better organised. And the union started getting better organised. And there was one MP who, she was, I think, let's put it mildly, on the fence. Until one Saturday morning, when this campaign was, about are we going to actually vote our government down if need be for doing this. They had other plans. There's no way that if we voted and won, would the government have fallen. That was the sort of black propaganda. But anyway, this MP who was uncommitted until two Saturdays before, a group of women who were affected by this spotted her in the high street and started to chase her. And she said, Gordon's head had started, the old thug started trying to get her up to vote. She said, look, I'm not going to be chased down the high street just because of you. And it was just a wonderful bit of direct politics. And we had the votes. So Gordon, the amount of money he put in as compensation, which never actually properly compensated mainly women who lost out on low pay with the 10p, it's a politics of madness. But anyway, but it's again, how do we underpin in a society where the bottom is falling out, the people who make fun.
In 2013, when it looked like Liam Byrne was going to be demoted from the shallow welfare role, it was reported that Maurice Glossman thought that you should replace Liam Byrne. Why weren't you put into the shadow cabinet, and do you think that Rachel Reid is being tougher on welfare than the Tories?
Well, I think Rachel is one of our stars. I really do. And it's going to be marvellous, because if there's problems after the next election, she'll be heavily pregnant with her second child. So, like John Major's toothache. She'll be out of Westminster for a while, so that would be good. Whether one would be tougher, I think we have to position ourselves properly, and set out our stall and not be scared off point at position after position as we are. Actually on welfare reform. But I have a problem, one of my problems is the Whips think I lose votes, so try and keep me off the media and all those sort of things, where actually I maybe it's a delusion, I think I genuinely win votes rather than lose them. I just think we just have a team of many colours, really. Of course you need the tough boys and all that, people can see the whites of your eyes. But if you look at our vote now, it's around 30%. 8 percentage points of that, i.e. we'd be on 22%, is ex-Liberals, Lib Dems. So we're down to 22% of our traditional vote. It would suggest, wouldn't it, we're not doing terribly well in reaching out. And the one thing that struck me from reading the book on the Reid lectures, he describes us human beings as we start to die. And some of us go out like a light, which is a wonderful blessing. Other of us die more slowly. Bits of our bodies just close down. And as I was that page, as I was reading about us, me, closing down, I thought, gosh, this is an analogy for political parties, and our three big political parties, we can call them big, are closing down with the electorate. That's why Greens are, that's why UKIP has risen up, in that we can't function in the way we did in reaching out to people and being broad enough and generous enough to see that sometimes truth's many-sided. And it's going to be interesting whether that can be reversed or not, or whether we're going to have a huge, in 10 years' time, multiplicity of parties, because people cannot fit themselves, their views within,
the two main parties.
You said yourself that you thought Labour should adopt some of UKIP's policies. Do you think that's a way they'll win back lost Labour voters?
Oh, I think UKIP's not an anti-European party. It's forgotten to mention it, hasn't it, recently? During the last European elections, it woke up and knew that lots of decent people were concerned about the level of immigration. And as neither the two main parties, well, the Liberals are in denial and all sorts of things, as neither of the two main parties would actually raise this issue, somebody got on the stage and started talking about it. I mean, I think it's wonderful the bishops have published that letter, but they said the debate about immigration has got nasty or unclean or something. Well, where were they leading it? I mean, they had a duty to say there were genuine concerns. If you look at London, which on the most modest figures since Labour came in 1997, 1 million people have come to live in London from abroad. That is the size of Birmingham. London has not had the housing stock of Birmingham added, or its schools added, or its hospitals added, or its roads, or its transport, any of that. And one of our problems, we've been talking about this, standard of living, cost of living crisis. I think people not being able to get the kids into schools of their choice. I believe public services help determine living standards. And there we are, not prepared to talk seriously until very recently about immigration, but also prattling on about the standard of living. Why do people take us seriously in that situation? And if we'd led this debate, we could have made it absolutely plain that everybody that's came here, and we have a duty. They're part of our society. When you don't do that, and the numbers keep rising, it must be at some stage it will become, and will be. I know because I talk to people in London. People come up and talk to me in London. They find it threatening. They're worried about what will happen to them. And if the main parties won't actually engage with the electorate, there's a tendency for nasty parties to arise and cater for nasty views. And those nasty views grow unless mainstream parties are prepared to confront them. And that means engaging with these issues. So I do think that UKIP's value is because it's raised that issue or got onto that issue, but also at the beginning of the parliament, talking to Ed, I said I thought England would become an issue in this parliament. I never believed it would become quite the issue it has been, and Labour's at a disadvantage in England because it's if you look at the English votes. And therefore, if this was going to become a big, powerful issue, we had to get in first. So it was our subject, and people thought we actually surprised them by talking about it. And as Gladstone showed, if you could get on first onto an issue, you can change people's voting loyalties for life. And I was really anxious that the Tories, as thick as they can be sometimes, didn't wake up that if they play the English card, they could actually be permanently in power, and I wanted us to be. And that means that we had to get in first, and that again, it was not unclean to talk about you're proud to be English, even if we've all got some reservations about being English, and I'm immensely proud to be English. And I think those views should be loud and clearly expressed in the Labour Party. That's not a threat to other people's identity. I have a number of identities. I try, to believe in Christianity. That's part of my identity. But people don't come in neat little boxes only having one identity now. And you could be English in all sorts of other things, or you could be British in all sorts of other things. But the multiplicity of identities, I think, is one of our great strengths as a country. It's not a strength to deny what most people think of themselves as being English. And it's very interesting on the census, where people could have put British, the majority putting themselves down as English this last census, without any encouragement at all. And we should go where the Scots have gone, and where the Welsh have gone, and where the Irish have gone, and recreate our sense of identity of being English. That's not to pick on other people, but to celebrate that.
There was an answer in the Independent on Tuesday that David Cameron wants young unemployed people to work for £1.91 an hour. Further in the Conservative manifesto commitment is withdrawing housing benefit from under 25s. In some countries, younger people have to wait much longer to get social housing, for example. Do you think this is a fair policy? Do you think Britain, people in Britain, need to rely more on the family or the state?
I think it's terrible that some young people think that some jobs, and I'll give you an example in a moment from Birkenhead, the one conversation I had that most shocked me, well, let me begin with it. The Sunday Times were doing something, and I thought, well, they were spending a day in Birkenhead, and I thought it would be very good for them to talk to young people who haven't got a job. And I thought, well, they'll be up by 11, won't they? Well, that was a mistake. Anyway, they came in at 11, staggered at 11:30 to talk with the Sunday Times. And I said to them about, you know, what about getting a job? And they said, no, Frank, you don't understand. This is why universal credit won't work. The idea that people just want 6 months more. No, Frank, no, we wouldn't get up to less than £300 a week. And I said, who's going to pay you £300 a week? You can neither read nor write. And it's partly we're trying to improve our schools, but you've got responsibility. You've had 14 years of investment from taxpayers. No, Frank, down. So we wouldn't get out for less than £300. Anyway, we got more and more heated. And I said, so one of them then spat at me across the table. Says, so you'd make us take immigrant jobs, would you? And I said, you bet I would if I had the power. The idea that you're better than somebody who's come over here and working, sitting on your backside all day, thinking taxpayers can support you. The idea that you think this is a pension you've got, you've never worked, you've never made a contribution, never paid in a penny. And I think that whole culture of disregarding people and not thinking, the idea that we dispense our responsibility by paying them benefits, we ought to be serious about working for your dole, if need be. The one great thing, and it was Alistair Darling who introduced it, of the last Labour government, was that programme of guaranteeing people work. And of course, as you build up these programs, it's difficult. And some of it isn't the quality that you want. But, you know, people had 6 months guarantee, and for lots of them, it made a real difference. Even if it only meant they got the discipline of getting up every day and having a shower and getting into work on time. I thought it was terrific, and that was the beginnings of a serious welfare strategy. And the Tories, of course, wouldn't publish the research on that and have abolished it. And if we're serious next time, we've got to say, in the meantime, you're going to have to, there'll be lots of jobs you can do while you're drawing your benefits. None of you are going to actually think, we so think you're unimportant, we're just going to pension you off on benefits. And I think we have to build up that programme that we did in that Alistair Darling started. It was one of the great things. You could see the difference on young people in Birkenhead who were actually part of it. But you saw the corrupting power of benefit with those three young people shouting at their MP that so your plan is to make us take immigrant jobs. I mean, the awfulness of that comment, that they thought themselves superior to people who travelled here to work. So I think we should, but that's one of the things I wanted to do since 1997. I mean, all these things where the Tories get in first, it makes us look so weak. Just by aping them later.
So do you think Cameron's right in wanting the unemployed to work for £1.91 an hour? Do you think it should be higher?
No, I think they should that they work for their benefit in the meantime while we try and build up job opportunities. And these are difficult. I mean, I don't know how many of you students who taught economics and all this baloney that that we should have had a Keynesian alternative to the crunch. I mean, Keynes would have died if he'd seen the size of the reflation, i.e. the size of the debt that we had each year we were buying. And when we left, for each £4, I've got the sign, for each of £4 the government was spending, one was being borrowed. the idea that we needed more reflation. We wouldn't have got full employment back by reflation. I mean, it was a reflation of a scale unknown to Keynes. And given that, that we're not clever enough to know what the theory is to get full employment, we have to be humble and start, how do we physically start to plan for it and to use what resources we have to make what's called make work and think of really useful things for the community to do, which people can take a pride in, which people can thank them for doing. Right? Better shut up.
Last question.
No, it's not the question, being quick, it's the answer. So sure.
It's known that you were commissioned by the coalition government when they came into power to look into social deprivation and poverty. But it was reported that you felt that you had been ignored and that your view on poverty and life chances hadn't even been read by the Prime Minister. Do you think that the coalition ever had a commitment to your report, or do you think it was a cynical ruse for the Tories to show that they were compassionate on issues of poverty and social justice?
Well, what the Prime Minister wanted me to do was to undermine, blow up the present measures of poverty, which are pretty inadequate. I mean, when we have rising unemployment, we have less poverty because the income distribution gets more concertina. The idea that's what we want, to solve poverty that way. And what I did say to him, I would do and I don't know why I chose the topic, I would do an analysis or report on life chances. And the report that I did, which it's very difficult to be Prime Minister and be a good dad. And he's a good dad, and he doesn't spend enough time being a Prime Minister. It's a real, it was a terrible, mega job, and terrible job to do, but great job to do, but terrible job to do. My neighbour in Birkenhead wants to be Prime Minister, I'm just doing an advert for her, Esther McRae. what I wanted to do is, could we not do these simple correlations, but was there enough, had social science developed enough so that we could see what were the drivers of poverty, and whether we could actually break those drivers so that the interventions were more powerful than class in determining where young children ended up. And our analysis, that's what's so great about the report. It's online, it's Foundation Years, Preventing Poor Children Becoming Poor Adults. And there's obviously what we do with young, what knowledge young people have about how they grow, the crucial business of the affection, the bonding, the growing of their children's brains. But also, when it's too late, what can you do where parents are already poor? What are the interventions that you can do which breaks the link those children are going to be poor? Thanks to World Council partly, but we're running this report in Wirral and looking at what are the interventions which actually will ensure that some poor children don't become poor adults. And we asked Cambridge University to start doing sets of indicators so we could measure the effectiveness of the interventions. And they did a school readiness one. They've got a posher name because teachers object to using the word school ready for school. Everybody, mum and dad knows what you mean by it. And we found from this analysis that there were a group of very poor children who were up in their cognitive skills, their physical skills and their social skills with the very richest children in the world. And my constituency, part of it makes Hampstead look down market, it's so rich, and parts of it are very, very poor. Cambridge dug down, why did this group of poor children, why were they up there with the rich? And they found all these children reported having fun at home. And it's clearly having fun engaging with your children. It has the same effect in developing their skills as actually having, being a good guardian reader and reading to your child at home. And it makes your interventions different. Because if you can't read and write yourself as a parent, the idea that you're going to do intervention to help parents read to their kids is absurd. But having fun with your kid makes the interventions totally different. And and I end on this point so we can open up but you know, the idea we now know probably not so how we can actually change life chances for poor children. That's always been the name of the centre-left in this country. We ought to be thrilled that we have the opportunities. And it isn't the old-fashioned class stuff or trade unions or bosses. We now know how to set the poor free, and it'd be brilliant to have a government that did that.
Do you think the coalition ever had a commitment to that vision of yours, or...?
I think both, I'm not letting Labour off either, because they say that, but what do they do? This is the key thing. I don't think either side, the leadership of either side, knows that within their grasp they could change this country. I mean, we've got this huge group who are poor, who find it so difficult to get jobs, who get so little out of our education system. The message of the report was, it's all over by the beginning of school. It's too late to leave it to school. All school does is the inequalities become slightly more during school. We don't close any gaps. We have to do it before young people get to school. It's the most, could be the most exciting election campaign, couldn't it? And all you as parents and grandparents know that one of the problems, we've seen the collapsing of parenting in this country and of young people not knowing, having no guidance, no framework, and all the rest of it. And it's a most, if we started this sort of conversation, we'd keep the electorate, you know, mesmerised until after polling day.